Well, thank you very much. I'm very honored to be here. As some of you know, I'm not a futurist. I'm just a humble director general for a public service company. And I'm going to talk to you a bit about reality of today, I was planning on. Because I think we got a lot of interesting information here today. And the tricky thing is, how do we use it now when we go back to our daily life? And even though Ruth said I'm going to tell you how to do it, I'm definitely not going to tell you how to do it. That would make it far too easy for you. You have to figure out what you want to use of today when you go home. And you have to decide what kind of changes you want to do in your company out of the circumstances you have. But let us not kid ourselves. Changes are needed. Transformation is needed. We're not going to throw away everything we do good today, but we have to look into the future because public service broadcasters in Europe are under a lot of pressure. How many of you recognize this? You have a severe headache most of the days because of political pressure at home or political uncertainty. Hands up. Can't see. Some hands up. Yes? Most. How many recognize this? Lack of money, financial pressure. Some hands I do see. So as you can see, some of us have political pressure at home, some of us have financial troubles at home, and some of us, unfortunately, have both. And that is the key for why we need to do changes, why we have to be on the top of our agenda. We have to take charge of our own future. Otherwise, other people will do it for us. And the key word is this. The key word for public service broadcasters in Europe is trust. Because if you do have trust from your public, if you do have trust from the audience, then it's much, much, much harder for people who want to harm you to actually succeed. And there is not one single recipe, of course, how to create trust. And I can't tell you how to do it. But I will tell you a story. And hopefully, by listening to this story, you will get a little bit inspired and you will get assured that you can do it if you take charge of your own future. Because this is my company, Swedish Radio, some years ago, and this is the situation we were facing. The trust was definitely not at the top. Our director general was fired, and with him went most of the management team. The audience figures were decreasing in all our channels, believe it or not. The economy was in crisis, and now I'm not talking about the financial situation of Sweden, I'm talking about my company. We didn't even have money to finance the next year's full schedule in our channels. And if you asked the audience, they thought we were trustworthy, okay. They thought we were independent, okay. But they perceived us to be very, very boring. So, as you can see, not a fun situation. What do you do? Well, we had a change of management, and the first thing we had to do was we had to set some priorities. And they were quite rough. 150 people, that's 10% of the workforce, they had to go. They had to leave the company, and they were not replaced. So the people that were left, they had to do more because we also had the whole digital world to take care of with less people. So then we said, this is the key word in our cooperation. Cooperation in my company. And why is this important? Because the enemy is not inside the company. The enemy is outside the company. We actually said to our managers that if you cannot cooperate, then you cannot be a manager any longer at the Swedish Radio. We also said that if you can come up with an idea of cooperation that would lead to a better content for the future, and you achieve this by working together with others from another department or another editorial room, we will give you some extra money to get you started. So people came up with all kinds of ideas that were really good and that really changed our content for the future, because still you have to have the content if you want to build trust with your audience. Now we don't have to do this anymore. We don't have to give money for cooperation. Everybody within Swedish Radio knows that this is the key word, and they live by it in their daily life. We also said that we have to do some changes, because you can't achieve anything, and you can't save your company from a crisis if you don't do some changes. And we divided them into three areas. We had to set some new journalistic priorities. We had to change on how we worked to reach the audience. And we also wanted to change the mindset of our journalists, how we did the journalistic work. Let's start with the journalistic priorities. For us, it's a high priority coming from a small country, it's foreign coverage. That is basically foreign correspondence. Another priority when it comes to content is real local presence. We have 25 local stations that are broadcasting from 6 in the morning until 6 in the afternoon. A third priority is culture coverage outside of the big cities. Fourth is going mobile. And the fifth is news, and especially investigative journalism. It's very easy to say that we are in a lack of money, let's cut something, and then you cut the things that cost you most, which is usually the investigative journalism part. But that is the wrong move, believe me. If you do that, you don't have anything that sticks out. Then you will be a provider like everybody else on the media market. So if you are a public service broadcaster, you have to set the agenda. You have to stick to your true journalistic work, and that is investigative journalism. By doing this priority, we last year had the biggest story we have had for 25 years within Swedish radio. It was about this, Saudi Gate. It was a Swedish plan how to help Saudi Arabia to build an advanced weapon factory in the desert that nobody knew about. Quite a good story. It took 8 months to do, 3 reporters. So also quite expensive story. It created 5,400 articles in other Swedish media, our story. It also created stories in big media in Europe, in the Middle East, in the US. And it created trust for Swedish radio, but it also boosted the morale among the personnel, because these people that did this got a lot of awards. And this is good for the inside morale, especially if you are saving money. And the defense minister had to resign, not to forget. So once you have set your priorities for the content, you also have to think about how will you reach your audience then. Well, some of you have heard me say this before. I think we as public service broadcasters have been quite snobbish. We have said that either you have to come to us and listen to us at FM, if you're a radio company like me, or at least you have to come to our website. In 2010, we changed this strategy. We said that our mission is not to get the audience to come to us, but to get the content to the audience. And this is a big change for being a public service company, at least in Sweden. We have to get the conversation going. One way of doing this is by this little small black embedded player that you can see behind me. It can be placed on any website. A commercial website, the tabloids, the unions, a private person, anybody can use it. And within this little player, they can put an entire radio program, an entire radio channel, or part of a program. And they do it. And by doing this, we created trust. We get a new audience that would normally not listen to us. And we have fairly truth with the newspapers, because they can use all our content on their websites. And the third thing, once you have set your priority for the content, you know how you want to reach your audience, is changing the mindsets of the journalists. Because at least in Swedish radio, we cannot change everybody we have and employ new ones. So you have to change the mindset among the ones you already have. And this is what I call Journalist 3.0. Journalist 1.0 is a traditional journalist, the one I have been all my life. You go out there, you do a story, you publish it, you have an editor-in-chief, and best of the world, someone can comment on it afterwards. Journalist 2.0 is basically social media, where anybody thinks that they are a journalist. It doesn't have to be correct. If it's not correct, you correct it afterwards. There's no editor-in-chief, and nobody gets paid to do it. Journalist 3.0 is combining these two. It's traditional media, traditional journalists, working together with the audience already before they start to produce their story. So not afterwards, before. And they use the knowledge of the audience, they use the enthusiasm of the audience, and they get a much bigger variety of what they produce. But we don't abdicate, we don't hand over the microphone, but we include the audience in our work. And why is this important? Well, if you use it correctly, you can play a very vital role within the democratic society. And I will give you one fresh example from Sweden. We have had a debate for weeks about what kind of word is okay to use without being called a racist. And this debate was mainly taking part within the Swedish parliament, among white middle-aged people, or on the editorial pages of our newspapers, also among white middle-aged people. And then we have an urban radio station called Metropol. They decided, well, let's turn the question around. Let's go out and ask the people who are actually receivers of these words how it felt. And even though we are a radio company, they did a little video and they placed it on YouTube.
Man vaknar och det är på Twitter, på Facebook, på mejlen.
Det känns som att man reser tillbaka i tiden.
Man har svar för att det var
det. Man tänker att en gång, alltså det är det, en gång, sa de vad de tror att de faktiskt sa.
På gymmet.
Fika, pausen, i skolan.
På ett möte, klokhet.
Man kommer ner till skolan, sa man.
And together with this video, they produced a hashtag on Twitter. Within a couple of days, they got 600 real stories from people that were actually telling how it felt to be a receiver of a racist remark. On the beach, in the school, in the store, on the bus. And that produced radio programs for an entire week. It filled up the channel. But it also turned the entire debate around in Sweden. We played a very vital role as a public service company in a democratic society. We used journalism 3.0, and we also created trust among a population in Sweden that hardly knew that Swedish radio existed. So we also got a new set of audiences. This is a good example on why it is important to include the ones that you're actually trying to cover when you do your coverage. So, that gives me the conclusion. When you go back home, make sure that you set the agenda if you are a public service company, because otherwise you will not be needed. Go to the audience. Don't sit and wait for them to come to you. And make sure that you make a difference within the democratic society. And if you do have a snobbish attitude at home, this is the time to get rid of it. Do you need a crisis to achieve this? We had a severe crisis when all this started. Well, I would say yes and no. If you have a crisis, it could help you in the process, especially internally, because it's easier to motivate people internally why they have to change. But even if you don't have a crisis, you should do this constantly. Look forward, look ahead, keep what you think is good, but do the necessary changes. Do the transformation, because this is the key how to avoid a future crisis. And this is Swedish radio today. Looks not as grim. The audience is definitely back. We have 5 million listeners every day, which is sort of more than half the population. And it's stable in all our channels. The finances are in fairly good shape, I would say. We only have to save 120 million Swedish crown this year. So I wouldn't say that they are tip-top, but they are in good shape. The trust is back. We are the most trusted company, all categories, not only media, all categories in Sweden by the population, Swedish Radio is. And as you can see, they see us as a very important news source. And if you are a public service company, this is extremely important. And as far as I know, the Director General is not about to be fired. So, as you can see, this can be achieved. You have to have something that I am lacking. You have to have patience to do this. It took us 5 years. But my message to you is really, take advantage of what you heard today. Go back, think about what you do good, that you should keep. Think about the necessary changes that you need to do, and do them. Don't sit and wait, because we can't wait. Otherwise, other people will take charge of our future. And good luck.